Thank you, Brother Mark, and good morning, my dear brothers and sisters in the Lord Jesus Christ. As you can probably guess from what we've read this morning and the songs and the hymn that we've just sung, we're talking about resurrection. We're not talking about just beginnings. We're talking about ends, glorious ends of life everlasting, and how we will be changed. Sir Isaac Newton was an English mathematician. He was also a physicist, an astronomer, a theologian, and he was also an author who was widely recognized as one of the most influential scientists of his time. The interesting thing about Sir Isaac Newton is that he wrote more words about the Bible than he did about science. Sir Isaac Newton is noted for his works on universal gravitation, gravity as I know it, and probably you do too. And he developed the three laws of motion, which form the basic principles of modern physics. His discovery of calculus led the way to more powerful methods of solving mathematical problems. And for all this, Newton himself was a firm believer in the Bible as God's inspired message to man. He felt that the greater contribution he could make to the world was to expound the Bible's message, not science. And one day, someone came along and asked him, as a scientist, could he believe in the resurrection of the body? And in reply, Newton took a handful of metal shavings and mingled them in a mound of dust together. And then he took a strong magnet, and some of us have probably done this at some stage in our life. He took a strong magnet, held it over the mound of sand, and proceeded to collect the metal shavings as they were resurrected from that sand. So in Newton's mind, resurrection was a reality to him, something that could happen. Now we come each week, don't we, here and partake of these memorial emblems that are set before us here, and the bread and the wine, which we understand are but emblems of his Jesus' body, that he's poured out lifeblood as a covering for our sins. And our daily readings have taken us, of course, through the epistle of Paul to the Corinthians, in particular this morning, chapter 15, that we'll focus on. And it's a lovely chapter. It's a chapter that's filled with great hope. Hope for you and me, hope for the future. It's a vision, if you like, a window here that we're looking at and looking through of the future. And it's held out to all of us who are faithful in our walk with the Lord Jesus Christ. Interestingly enough, we find when we read through these verses that we read through this morning in this chapter, and it says here, a question is being asked as how you believe in the resurrection of the body. And that was a question that some of these Christian Corinthians were posing. As a matter of fact, when we read through here, some of them were even denying the future resurrection. Paul incredulously asks here in verse 12, doesn't he? He's appalled that they could even pose this question. How can some of you say that there is no resurrection of the dead? And that's precisely the issue that Paul is dealing with here in 1 Corinthians 15. He's presenting arguments here demonstrating the certainty of the final resurrection. Paul emphasizes some four times in verses 12 to 19 that those who deny the physical and bodily resurrection of believers also deny the bodily resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ, even if they claim the latter to be true. You see, the resurrection of Jesus is an historical fact. Paul reminded the Corinthian believers of the one thing that made them believers in the very first place, and that was their faith in the gospel, their faith in the good news of Jesus Christ. What they believed was essential because the gospel was, and the gospel still is today, the power of God to salvation to all who believe. As Paul says in Romans chapter 1, verse 16, I'm not ashamed of the gospel, says Paul. And there's no hiding, is there, of his light under a bushel. I'm not ashamed of the gospel, for it is, and you probably know the words, it is the power of God to salvation to everyone who believes, to the Jew first and to the Gentile also. Yes, you see, Paul was eager, wasn't he, in his life to preach the gospel because the message of salvation was coming with the power of God. And the gospel is the good news. It is the good news that Jesus died for our sins and that he was buried and truly dead. And on the third day, God raised Jesus from the dead. And Paul goes to some length to emphasize this in the opening words of this chapter we read from this morning. You received what I delivered, he said. I'm passing on intact to you the information that I received from others. He's saying to the Corinthian brothers and sisters, you don't have to put your hope in myths that couldn't be validated. Instead, they could verify and have confidence in historical facts about the death and the resurrection of our Saviour, the Lord Jesus Christ. Everything about Jesus was unique. The prophecies of his coming, his birth was unique, his life was unique, his teachings were unique, his miracles were definitely unique, his death was unique, and especially his resurrection was unique. His resurrection is an historical fact that has stood the test of time. You see, the whole of Scripture hinges on the fact that Jesus Christ rose from the dead. And if we do not accept this, then our faith is totally in vain. We would have no faith, brothers and sisters. The promises to the patriarchs, to Abraham, to Isaac, and Jacob would be worthless. And even back in Genesis, that covenant that God made with Adam and Eve, their descendant, Jesus Christ, would bruise the serpent's head, would have no meaning at all, would it? Jesus' resurrection is the fulcrum upon which all our hopes are realized. It is the mortar, if you like, that binds Scripture together, the Old and the New Testaments. The resurrection of Jesus is the real hope of the gospel, the good news, which brings hope in this life, even in the face of death in this life. And all these, when speaking about the roll call of faithful in Hebrews, the writer says, and all these, though commended through their faith, did not receive what was promised. And what was the promise? It says, by faith, they desired a better country, that is, a heavenly one. And the Apostle Paul, in his opening remarks in the Epistle to Romans, reaffirms how Jesus fulfilled the Old Testament prophecies that a descendant of David would rule forever. And hence he is the Messiah. And he says Jesus was declared to be the Son of God in power according to the Spirit of holiness by his resurrection from the dead. Jesus Christ our Lord, through whom we receive grace and mercy, including you who are called to belong to Jesus Christ. And that you and I, brothers and sisters. So back in our reading of 1 Corinthians 15, Paul moves from the hypothetical to the very fact in verse 20. He says, but in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead. And Paul goes on to remind Corinthian believers that while death entered into the world through the sin of Adam, life and resurrection entered the world through Jesus Christ. And he goes on to remind believers that all power has been given to Jesus, all power. And that in the end, Jesus will put, as we read this morning, all enemies under his feet, conquering and destroying death. You see, without resurrection, faith and the testimony of faith in our baptism would be pointless, wouldn't it? Without the resurrection, why would it matter how we live this life, if this life is all that there is? But the reality is that the resurrection of Jesus is the proof of God's victory over sin and death. And in the proof of the resurrection of Jesus, believers can have confidence in God's victory over sin and death in our lives. And Paul goes on to expand this position, this positive statement about Jesus' resurrection by stating that he has become the first fruits, it tells us here, of all those who have fallen asleep. Down through the millennia, those true believers of the Lord Jesus Christ, he's become the first fruits of all those who have fallen asleep. You see, Christ's resurrection, grounded in the truth of eyewitness testimony, as he mentions in verses 4 to 6 here of 1 Corinthians 15, changes everything. If Christ had not been raised, how is it that he was seen by Peter, then the 12, and still further later by 500, as says here, brothers at one time, of whom some are still alive in their very midst? So there was this wonderful, privileged group of people that could still attest to the living Lord Jesus Christ when this epistle was written. A resurrected Jesus Christ. If God raised Jesus from the dead, then Jesus was truly the first fruits, or the first of many others who would be raised from the dead, isn't he? When we look back in the Old Testament, in Leviticus, Israel in Leviticus 23 is instructed to bring before the Lord the first fruits of the harvest. They were to present them to the priest on the Sabbath day. And if we turn up Leviticus, we won't necessarily now, it says, he, that is the priest, shall wave the sheaf before the Lord that you may be accepted. On the day that you wave the sheaf, you shall offer a male lamb a year old without blemish as a burnt offering to the Lord. The offering was and had to be of the best of their crop, didn't it? And it was to dedicate and celebrate the entire harvest as a blessing from God given to his people. But in addition, we note, don't we, that we have to offer a lamb without spot and blemish. The Lord Jesus Christ was that lamb for us without spot and blemish. And so we have in Leviticus here then this wonderful foreshadowing, don't we, of the Lord Jesus Christ. He was the first fruit, the choicest of all those who would follow. He was the offering, wasn't he, without spot and blemish, given to the Lord God in complete obedience to his will, offered up on our behalf for the covering of our sins. And when we go back and look a little closer at Leviticus chapter 23, in that verses of 9 to 11, it says, so that you may be accepted. So that you may be accepted. This just wasn't any offering, was it, brothers and sisters? Well, I know I have to do it. It's a requirement that I need to do each harvest, and, well, I really don't mind. After all, the crop's been abundant, and I could at least spare some. It was the best that they could offer. It had to be of their first fruit. And why? Because it says, so that they or you may be accepted. Well, what was being accepted? It was all the hard work. It was all the cultivating. It was the sowing or the planting. It was the nurturing. It was the watering. The bringing to fulfillment, the best that that person could produce. And in doing so, they were to give of this crop to the very best of that crop, to the Lord. You see, in Leviticus 23, the emphasis is upon the offeror, the person bringing the offering. And the person bringing the offering had to do something in return for this abundant goodness that had been shed upon them. It required, didn't it, a response on their part. It requires a response on our part for the rich blessing that had been given to ensure that they were to be found acceptable before God. It wasn't to be ritualistic. Well, every year I have to do this. It wasn't to be ritualistic that we come here this morning, necessarily. No. It had to be with heartfelt thanks. The only way that they could find favour with God was in thanksgiving and offering their best to the Lord. So what sort of reaction, brothers and sisters, are we to give for the manifold blessings that God has showered upon us in giving of his only Son? The Lamb, as we've said, that is without spot and blemish, who willingly gave himself upon that tree for our salvation. Yes, like Israel, God is expecting a reaction from you and I. God is expecting a sacrifice from you and I. God is expecting us to respond through work and prayer and cultivation and worship and praise to Him. Yes, God is looking for us to give of our best in service to Him. And the thing is, the crop will never come to fruition if we just sit idly on our hands and expecting something is going to happen. Paul writes in the second epistle of Corinthians, and at chapter 9, he says, the point is this, he says, whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and whoever sows bountifully will reap bountifully. Each one must give as he has decided in his heart, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. Each one must give as he has decided in his heart. And we each know what's in our hearts, don't we? But that's the response that God is seeking for us. But unlike our Lord Jesus Christ, who was sinless, we know that we struggle, don't we? We all have those pressures upon us day to day. We all stumble. And yet God has told us that He is ever present. We never come into God's presence. God is always present with us. Even now, God is present with us. But it is this risen Lord Jesus, that we actually worship, isn't it? And remember again this morning here in these emblems before us. What a wonderful opportunity the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ gives us. The late brother Alfred Norris, in his book Understanding the Bible, says this: the cross without the resurrection would lack its power. The cross without the resurrection would lack its power. It would be the wisdom of God without His might. The resurrection of Jesus proved then that the life which He had lived had been altogether acceptable to God in heaven. And it went on, didn't it, by disproving something. It disproved the taunts of those who mocked Him upon the cross, didn't it? He saved others. Himself He cannot save. But as we know from the Gospels, Jesus speaks of His crucifixion and His resurrection. And He began to teach them, it says in Matthew's record, that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected of the elders and the chief priests and the scribes and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. It goes on to say that the Lord spoke to them plainly. Hopefully that's what I'm doing this morning. But Peter found this hard to understand, and as we know, he takes the Lord aside and rebukes Him. And it's quite likely, with Peter and the others too at that time, that with only the Old Testament scriptures to reflect on, that Peter could well have been thinking of Daniel when he speaks of that great time of trouble. And that's what it would appear to them within their own country at that time under Roman rule, wouldn't it? A great time of trouble. This was the time when Daniel says, when Michael the great prince would take charge of his people, and it goes on to say that at that time your people shall be delivered and of many of those who sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake, some to everlasting life, and some to shame and everlasting contempt. And probably that's what Peter was struggling with. They were under the tyrannical rule of the Romans at that time. There was a lot of pressure on them day by day. And in this statement, though, that Jesus makes, he says that he will rise again in 3 days, would quite possibly have puzzled the disciples, because they were looking for relief now, the now generation. It had to happen now. Jesus himself faithfully taught his disciples that it was the one who should lose his life who would save it. Then we must truly recognize that our Lord Jesus Christ will return and reward the faithful. Now, whilst we didn't read all this chapter of 1 Corinthians 15 this morning, Paul goes on to use the elements of this natural world, doesn't he? He talks about the various seeds. And he uses that example to explain that God will change our bodies at resurrection. And he says in Philippians chapter 3, but our citizenship is in heaven, and from it we await our Saviour, the Lord Jesus Christ, who will transform our lowly body to give his glorious body by the power that enables him even to subject all things under him. As Paul says earlier in that epistle to the Philippians, speaking of himself, he says, I'm not perfect, and neither are we. He's still involved in the struggles of life when he writes these things to the Philippians. The full glory of the resurrection remains, doesn't it, for us all in the future, some 2,000 years removed from when these things were penned. Not that I have already obtained this or am already perfect, says Paul, but I press on to make it my own ownership. I press on to make it my own because Christ Jesus has made it his own. Yes, what is perishable will become imperishable. What is dishonorable will become glorious. What is weak will become powerful. Paul reminded the believers that just as they inherited the fallen image of sinful man, through their faith in a risen Lord Jesus Christ, they will be resurrected and inherit the glorious image of Christ himself. Yes, the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ reveals the future reality of resurrected life. It's a fact for those that put their faith in him. It will be eternal. It will be glorious beyond our imagination. They will be spiritual bodies that perfectly reflect the image and the glory of Jesus Christ, the one we've come to dwell on this morning here, represented in the bread and the wine. You see, Paul's message to the Corinthians and to us is simple. Stand strong in your faith of the gospel. Stand strong in your faith of the good news. And keep doing the work of the Lord, knowing that through God's grace, there will be an eternal reward in the resurrection to come. Paul writes to the Ephesians. In Ephesians 4, he says, but God being rich in mercy, that's a statement in itself, isn't it? Rich in mercy. Because of the great love with which he loved us. Of the great love which he loves us. Present tense, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. How? By grace you have been saved. And it's the grace and the mercy of our Father in heaven that we remember once again this morning. So that in the ages to come, he might show the immeasurable. Immeasurable. We can't measure it beyond understanding that part. The immeasurable riches of his grace in kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. The resurrected Lord Jesus. In other words, the resurrection of Jesus gives us the motivation to stand firm in our faith, knowing that we can have victory over death and eternal life promised to us at Jesus' return. Yes, there is much required of the disciple as we prepare for the coming of our resurrected Lord, isn't there? There's watchfulness, there's faithful witness, there's encouragement of our brothers and our sisters. There's patient waiting, and there's more besides. The Epistle of Peter, chapter 1, Peter speaks of Jesus and us this way. He says, as you come to him, and that's what we're doing this morning, we are coming to him. A living stone rejected of men, but in the sight of God chosen and precious, precious. You yourselves, like living stones, are being built up as a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood. So this one Jesus, the risen Lord Jesus, although rejected of men, has risen from the dead and becomes a living stone, the foundation of God's new temple and believers, such as you and I are living stones in God's new temple, a spiritual house. But believers are not only part of God's temple, are they? But they are also able to offer up spiritual sacrifices in our praise, in our worship, and in our prayers to our Father in heaven. Yes, God's ear is always open to us because he is ever present. And the thing is that God actually wants to hear from us. The writer to the Hebrews puts it this way, through him then, that is Jesus, let us continually offer up a sacrifice of praise to God, that is, the fruit of our lips. Let it be the first fruit of our lips that acknowledge his name. Yes, our Lord Jesus Christ, our living Lord Jesus Christ, that we come to remember this morning, is the elect Messiah from God. His whole life is an exhortation to us, isn't it, brothers and sisters? And Peter tries, and I'm sure endeavours, to encourage his readers. He says here, for to this you have been called, because Christ also suffered for you, leaving you an example, doesn't he, that you might follow in his footsteps. He himself bore our sins in his body upon that tree, that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. Yes, we have a wondrous hope, brothers and sisters. It's a hope that is set upon a risen and living Lord Jesus Christ. The last verse of 1 Corinthians 15, we didn't read it this morning, says this, therefore, my beloved brothers, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that in the Lord your labour is not in vain.